And welcome back. Exploring more of Government Square. Let's talk to this Levy. All requests for city documents are handled by the council clerk. Please expect prolonged delays. Great. The statue behind me depicts Chilla the Great. The council makes no guarantee of its accuracy. Chilla the Great. Stylized writing along the base of the statue reads, Chilla the Great, who struck off our chains. Council clerk. Let's talk to these townspeople. Perhaps I'll stop by the bakery before I go home, eh? Got one of those flaky little pies. So Allison, we talked to her last episode. Petitioner? 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 What are these petitioners? What is taking so long? I'm only here for a simple rant. I have been waiting for my turn since yesterday. I'm not exaggerating. You waiting to talk to this lax spawn too? I need my shipment released. Gotta say, the man knows how to make people wait. Alright, where should I go next? I'll run up and see what's over there. Those crazy fish are at it again.
With alacrity.
With alacrity. Oh, there's children's over here. Hello, children's. You ain't seen a lady with a silver belt, have you? Only a plotter paid us to watch for her. Not necessarily. I wasn't looking out for belts. Some plotter in a hood gave us 10 shins to watch for some lady with a silver belt. What were you supposed to do when you found her? Trash is piled against this building as if someone has been sweeping the square each day and leaving all the detritus here. Detritus? Detritus? I think it's detritus. I think that's the word I learned recently.
Go.
Detritus. Interesting. Oh, Gibra? Gibra dignitary? Hail. Hello. Is it always this warm?
Yes.
I don't know. Don't really live here. Hail, townsperson. I come up here every day to have lunch. The buildings are so beautiful. Your grammar leaves much to be desired. Hello, Levy. Pleasant day to you, visitor. Are you looking for the Order of Truth? The entrance is downstairs. There's a nanos. A couple nanos here. I'm a nano too! My esteemed colleague is, with respect, an ass. You. Yes, you. Would you please tell my colleague she doesn't know what she's talking about? I'm not getting involved with your crap. Alright, down the stairs. Order of Truth. What's here? Carved into the base of the statue are the words, The Order of Truth. Oh, that would make sense. Is this some kind of ladder of some kind? I'm not gonna go there again.
Right.
Some merchants and stuff. We've been in negotiations with this mad visitant for over 3 hours. Ah, an outsider. Good. I seek clarification of a strange matter. Too bad I can't actually help you. We are trying to reach an agreement on spice prices. However, our Argelian friend is being difficult. Well, I can't actually help you. My interaction is limited. Climone is my dearest friend, but exhausting nearly all of my time. Well, it's about... Oh, you're not the guide, are you? Damn. I'm gonna go back to that ladder. There's a bridge over troubled waters. Oh, that goes to Caravanserai. You notice I'm saving this for last, the council and stuff. Order of Truth. I just want to, like, look around the outside first. So there. That's stairs. Oh, ladder to the underbelly. Right, I don't want to go to the underbelly yet. Okay. So we know what that is.
Ready.
See if there's anything around here.
Yes.
Yes. What the hell is this? I really don't want to screw with this thing. Do I? I don't think so. I'm gonna save that. I'm saving a lot of stuff for last. Let's go deal with these people. If you need assistance, perhaps our captain, Sigyn, can help. Here's Sigyn. Apologies, visitor. No one is permitted to enter Council Tower. Let's talk to the clerk first. Behind a lectern, a four-eyed, hairless mutant. Looks like he has hair. Blonde hair? I don't know. Processes paper with balletic grace. He's endlessly snapping the elegant fingers of his left hand, and each time the air twists and shimmers, either disgorging a document to be processed or accepting one that he has completed with his ink-stained right hand. Each of his eyes regards a distant object. Portals that are opening, preambles, and recitals that must be reviewed. His own addenda that must be flawless. One eye twitches in your direction. Exaggerated scorn twists his mouth, and though his eye remains fixed on your face, he gives no verbal acknowledgement. The closest he comes is a faint sigh. At last, after shunting a half dozen more documents to some distant cubby, he condescends to speak. You must wait, of course, until council matters conclude. His quarter gaze leaves you. His face returns to its former equanimity, and he continues his work, which shows no evidence of slacking, let alone concluding. You'll say this is really well written. I really enjoy reading this stuff to you guys. Intimidation. Persuasion. Quick fingers. How long do you expect council business to take? The clerk rolls his idle eye skyward, then answers in a voice that feigns having been worn down by endless pestering petitioners. Though, as far as you can see, you're the only one bold enough to bother him. Consider in so vast a city what ordinances must be registered, contracts memorialized, indictments docketed, discoveries catalogued, edicts promulgated, memoranda routed, applications processed, permits issued, titles recorded. From such consideration, you may draw your own conclusions. Do you know when yet you'll be done? The clerk sighs with exasperation and does not even give you a glance. I will spare you further recitation of the scope of my work, with the understanding that you will spare me important questioning about when it will cease. I'd just like to talk to you for a short moment. The clerk continues filling and filing papers for a rather long moment. Just when it seems he will not respond at all, he answers, I have no time for idle chit-chat, least of all while there is pressing council business to attend to. Is there anything I can do to hurry things along? The clerk continues his masterful shuffling of papers from one portal to another, flicking a closed scroll through a gateway with a particularly deft gesture. Then he turns not one, but two eyes your way. If you are inquiring whether I would let your sweating butcher's fingers touch the council's paperwork, I fear for the state of your mind. His eyes look away, and he adds, Of course, it is customary to render a small gratuity in thanks to civil service. One eye quickly glances back. What exactly is the customary gratuity? Not so much of a shrug of his shoulders or an inflection that would acknowledge impropriety, let alone shame, the clerk announces 60 shins. That's almost all my money. 60 shins is far too much. The clerk glares at you with one eye. We are not merchants haggling over the price of an anine, madam, he scoffs. Custom does not bend to circumstance, nor do civilized people chisel at gifts. You really think I'm going to pay a bribe? What did I gain? Indigo tide? Really? All four of the clerk's eyes momentarily open wide with dismay. Of course not, he cries, aghast. Receiving a bribe is a criminal act as set forth in sections 201 and 1951 of the Criminal Code. By contrast, accepting certain customary payments is an understood and lawful emolument associated with this position. His tone is utterly sincere, fanatical even, as he pronounces this distinction. And he thinks, this city will crumble into the sea before I accept the bribe. Oh, so silver and indigo went up. Let's try persuasion. I assure you that my matters are important enough to be worth a moment of your time. This is important, let's... Yes, we did it. Success! The clerk conveys his personal regard for the importance of your matters with a long, loud sigh, but he focuses one of his eyes on you and replies, very well, very well. Let us weigh the worth of your needs, shall we? What is it that you want? I'd like to talk about paperwork. A faint sigh is the only acknowledgement you receive. Now, I don't want to ask him general questions, because I fear that that'll be like, you know, I have one thing to say, and that'll be it. And then he'll just excuse me. Oh, can I spend my keener as well? I'm trying to obtain a letter of pardon for a man named Riss who has been wrongfully sentenced to die. Making a note. A capital case? The clerk mutters. Better to try to shake shins out of a Navarine. After a moment he sighs and says, the only person who can help you with that is a member of the council. And not just any member, one with enough power to persuade a few colleagues to sign off on such clemency. If you have such a sponsor, I will submit the necessary paperwork. With a one-eyed glance and a faint smirk, he adds, good luck. Persuasion is... Tell me again how to get the letter of pardon. The clerk shakes his head. Can you remember nothing? It's quite simple. You will need a powerful member of the council to intervene on behalf of this Riss. If you have such a sponsor, I will submit the necessary paperwork. Do I want to lie? Do you have any records about someone named Matkina? I've seen the name, he mutters, in far too many requisitions for discretionary funds. With confident but deliberate speed, he reviews a series of documents, which seem to confirm his initial impression. She does not appear as a citizen, nor in any census. Instead, she is mentioned nowhere but on ledgers and requisitions. Fully three of his eyes give you a significant look. Needless to say, these are transactions whose nature is not specified. What exactly are you doing with all those papers? The clerk shakes his head at your ignorance. I am taking them from where they were to where they must be, by bending the space between. And as they pass across my lectern, I assure that they are properly prepared. To the body politic, I serve as heart, kidney, and nervous system all in one. He snaps his fingers, opening a portal and flicking a scroll through it. You know what? I'm thinking of the game Portal. You know, I'm thinking of the blue and the orange portal. Papers coming in and out. Before I undertook this role, the council employed layers and layers of logothetes? I don't know what that is. Scriveners, registrars, and couriers. Each corruptible, vulnerable, insular. The memoveras, tendrils, grew through the cracks in that teetering edifice. He stares at you with two bright eyes. But now there is only myself. Had I not come to this office, I wonder who would rule the city. He thinks, not that the Memovera has not tried, but even she cannot corrupt the incorruptible. You know what I just noticed? His is gold, which I think is justice and such. I didn't realize it before. The thoughts show up in the text color of whatever their tide is. Makes sense. Pretty cool. Who is the Memovera? The clerk scowls without looking up. Some builders raise monuments of marble. Others tear the monuments down, cook the marble to lime, mix the lime into concrete, and use the concrete to make hardened bunkers. He shakes his head. Organizations can be made the same way. And people. The Memovera has demolished many things, and from the rubble has built an impenetrable organization of hardened souls. You would be wise to keep your distance. An eye glances your way, but don't look wise. Where can I find the Memovera? The clerk chuckles quietly while filling out a form. The bloom. A moment later, he adds, sometimes it seems one can indeed judge a book by its cover. Yeah, I don't like you very much either. I have more questions about paperwork. Or I don't. I'd like to ask you some general questions. A faint sigh is the only acknowledgement you receive. Who are you, and what exactly are you doing with all those papers? I am neither a tourist attraction nor a docent, he sniffs, but the irritation in his voice is only a thin disguise for the obvious pleasure he takes at your interest. He elaborates, I am the council clerk, and unto me falls the responsibility of directing the fate of every official document in Sega's clefts. His tone becomes wholly boastful as he continues, I am the mind that channels the blind, nervous impulses of this city, and turns it into muscular action. He preens, adding a certain flair to his routing of the paperwork. Nature, of course, provides every being with its proper niche, and here my power to bend space, my divisible vision, and my unerring integrity allows me to carry out a task no other in the ninth world could possibly undertake. He sighs, but with rapture, not exasperation. A venal man, a distractible man, an ordinary man would break beneath the temptation and strain, but not I. With that, his bureaucratic scowl returns. What exactly is the council, and how does it govern Sega's clefts? The clerk sniffs. Paper governs Sega's clefts. Paper allows the few to rule over the many. Paper allows the many to organize into a single whole. Authority resides in diktats, compacts, agenda, the means by which thoughts are refined, disseminated, and preserved. In a calmer voice, he adds, of course the council has a part as well. Each of the great slave families sends a representative, and they dicker and bicker until they form the will embodied in paper. And I am their clerk. Can you tell me about the city's history? Why exactly would an overburdened clerk be able or willing to recite this city's sad tale of decline? Then a certain twinkle appears in all four of his eyes, and he begins to speak. Here is what the documents themselves reveal, not in their words, but in their very selves. He works faster as he tells the story. Centuries ago, when the Ninth World was fresh, the city began. Its founders kept meticulous records, all lost. Only the columbarium that held them remains. A time of aristocrats followed. Each paterfamilias traced his lineage to ancient heroes and inscribed these lies in stone. Today, these tablets pave the midden heaps built in the wake of Chilla's rebellion. He clucks his tongue in distaste. That came later. First came the Tabat, and they laid siege to Sega's cliffs, the city's records degraded. Like hygiene and decency, proper documentation falters in long years of terror. With a shrug and no detail, he adds, but the siege failed, and the Tabat vanished. Yes, and one of their number sits in a Circus Minor. I forget what he's called. Next, an age of decadence, the long gestating consequence of the aristocracy's ever more outlandish choices. In screeds, they laid out their reasons to the people, not to explain, but to mock, smirks. Naturally, rebellion followed. Chilla cast down the old lords and raised up new slave families. An empire expanded, contracted. Holidays and boulevards changed names. All else persisted. Corruption, most of all. At last, a new clerk came, bringing order. He bows. And here we are. You must have uncovered some fascinating stories about the city and all this paperwork. Naturally, the clerk replies, but for a moment, notions of privacy and probity keep him quiet. Then one of his eyes flicks in your direction, and you can see he's avid to indulge the twin pleasures of the voyeur and the gossip. There's this, from an ambassador sent to the Steadfast. He snaps his fingers, summons a dispatch, clears his throat, and reads. Today, with great ceremony, the Aeon priests buried a man said to have lived for 277 years. I asked how this graybeard had lasted so long and was told as follows. 300 years ago, there was a painting of spectacular beauty hung in the Dirkhal, a relic from before the Ninth World. For reasons unknown, the work was incomplete. The Amber Pope believed that if I vanished, it would reveal a truth about human nature that had eluded all intellectual inquiry. He proclaimed that whatever painter could complete it would receive a cipher that would enable him to live for 250 more years. Great artists flocked to the Turkal to examine the masterpiece, but when they saw it, none dared lift a brush. At last, a young whitewasher approached, carrying brushes and rollers and buckets of paint. "I can finish this," he declared. The Amber Pope nodded, and the boy flung an entire bucket of paint across the canvas. The blank region was filled, but the painting was splattered with white, its majesty gone. The Pope held to his vow and bestowed longevity upon the whitewasher. He was, however, borne to the torture pits below the Turkal, where he remained until that very day, when at long last his life ceased. Damn, that's horrible. Get to live longer and be tortured more. The clerk folds the faded dispatch, returns it to his envelope, and sends it away, saying no more. I just want to see what he says for these other things. With rather less pleasure than the last time, he answers, "I am the council clerk. I am responsible for all official documents in the city." Tell me about the council again. "It is a ruling body formed from representatives of each of the great slave families. As you know, I am their clerk." And with the city's history again. "Without looking your way, with feigned sneering incitement, the clerk recites, 'An age of lords and ladies, a war against the fierce Tabat hordes, one slave's brave stand for freedom, expansion and retrenchment.' Could you tell me another story you've discovered?" The answer is yes. "After Chilat tore down the old ruling families, there was a time when the council stripped the euphemisms from its ledgers, and one sees such and such paid for racking a nobleman till he gave up his stash of shins and such to settle the claims of mothers bereft of their children by rampaging mobs." He pauses. "One could debate whether this is shamelessness or transparency, but has yielded an entry of terse brilliance, a sum allotted for the assassin to dispose of said whale." Okay. He smirks. "In a less literal age, said whale might have been the spendthrift scion of a mercantile clan, or a contessa of grand scale, but not here. These were funds requisitioned to assassinate a whale, no more, no less." The eye regarding you twinkles with delight, and best of all, it seems the mission failed. One wonders, how does an assassin miss a whale? Another story? Red ink. I don't know how many stories he has, the clerk declares. "For centuries, the council's amanuensis would record the council's commentary on proposed legislation with red ink. Then the draft law would be returned to the solicitors in the basement of the council tower to frame anew." He plucks an example from the air, a regulation concerning the stabling of anean. "You see?" He sends it back once it came. And then, abruptly, the annotations are in blue ink. An eye stares at you. "Why?" he asks rhetorically. "One finds in the criminal docket an entry concerning a solicitor executed for waste of official resources, to wit, 8,216 liters of red ink." "Drowning," was the sentence. The clerk shrugs. "I suppose he was not drowned in red ink." He snaps his fingers and produces a thick sheaf of papers, which he thumbs through like a deck of cards. Each is covered in red revisions. Draft after draft after draft. It seems he could never get it quite right. The clerk looks at you and smiles. "So? No more red ink." Another story? The clerk shakes his head without looking away from his work. "I've indulged your curiosity far enough." "Good. Let me get about Makina. She was a very well-paid phantom who exists outside the bounds of citizenship. I trust you will draw your own inferences." Tell me again how the city's records are kept. "By me," he answers, uninterested in explaining again his overwhelming importance to the well-being of Sagus Cliffs. Okay. The clerk gives no acknowledgement that he heard and barely continues with his work. Okay. Alright, so let's talk to this Sigyn. This woman is dressed much like the Levies who flank her, but unlike them, her expression is sober and alert. Her hair is cut short, the corners of it, her eyes wrinkled with crow's feet. A little swarm of mechanical drones circles around her, buzzing messages in her ears. She whispers replies in return, and every so often one of them whisks away, disappearing into the city. What is it, citizen? She pauses, eyes darting to your tattoo, then to your face. No. You're the one they call Adan. I heard you were in the city. No way. Adan is... for those of you who have not played Planescape Torment, or might not recall, there's a series of answers when somebody asks the Nameless One who he is. For whatever reason, you can tell them you're Adan. And I don't know where the name comes from. As far as I know, no one in the game ever says, or in a story rather, either, ever says Adan. It just happens to be this option that's put down the bottom of the selections. You could tell them your name's Adan. Nobody knows who Adan is, as far as I know. It's just that, okay. Hi, Adan. You know, I don't know. They don't really respond. Like, holy crap, you're Adan. No one, it's just a made-up name, I think. I'm not even sure. But this is completely a reference to Planescape Torment. Pretty awesome. You sense a sudden wariness in her. It's been 10 years since your last visit. I was too young to know you then, but the drones remember. Huh. What do the drones remember about me? Silvertide. On cue, two of her attendant drones dip closer in her ear, emitting a stream of raspy noise that might be some sort of language. You kept to your own affairs, but everywhere you went, the city held its breath. People deferred to you, even the ones with power and influence. You look the same as you do now. Exactly the same. I want to know why. If you don't mind telling me, I want to know what you're doing in Sagus now. She thinks, the stories they tell me are troubling. I'll have to keep an eye on this one. Does she think we're the changing god? Okay. So everything, all our options are basically playing along with that, she knows us. I'm looking for a woman named Matkina. The White Death. Her expression goes flat, but her eyes flick to your tattoo again. I should have guessed that. If Matkina is all you want, then you should ask for her in Underbelly. That's the last place any of my drones saw her, and the Levies don't venture there. She leans a little closer and lowers her voice. And if you leave the city afterward, I'd be very happy if you took her with you. Another drone sweeps past you, stopping just short of the woman's head. It unleashes a series of raspy buzzes and squawks. She whispers something to it, then glances back in your direction. What was it you wanted? Who are you? Sigyn, Captain of Levies. I'm not a Levy myself, but I command them. What are Levies? She gestures at the two burly, smiling men to her left and right. They're smiling? I can't see their faces covered with helmets. They look like identical twins. Yes, they're wearing the same armor. Soldiers in the Council's service. They keep order in the city. Her lips purse briefly, but she continues. Every citizen is required to raise a levy for the city's defense. The price is a year of their lives. Huh. Do your levies keep every district safe? Safe, not Underbelly. No, she frowns. Underbelly lives under its own law. Cliff's Edge lives under no laws at all. If the Levies don't keep order in Underbelly, then who does? A man called Fulsome. Her expression is unreadable. I don't know anything about him, she thinks, except that the Council needs him and so he does whatever he likes. Why don't you send any Levies to Cliff's Edge? A lot of homes have been collapsing, and the city hasn't been able to help. Her tone is cautiously neutral. The Council believes that the presence of Levies could incite them to violence. She thinks, it's the Memovira. The council's giving her free rein outside the bloom as well. How are Levies raised? Anyone who lives in a city can become a citizen at 16 years of age, or the equivalent if they're not human. There's only one requirement. They step into a machine at the Order of Truth, and it takes away a year of the citizen's life. It uses that year to create a Levy. She lowers her voice, seemingly for the benefit of the Levy standing beside her. That 1 year is all a Levy gets. When it's over, they die. Why do all the Levies look the same? They don't, but the differences are subtle. Citizens can usually tell their own Levies apart from the rest. She glances at one of the smiling Levies standing next to her. I don't know why they look so much alike, but they're all born from the same machine in the Order of Truth. Huh. They seem awfully happy. A smile and a pleasant demeanor could have 100 explanations, yet this whole city is fooled by them. She shakes her head. I know the Levies better than anyone, so the truth is plain to me. Though I'd be lying if I claimed to truly understand them. She thinks, if I only had a year to live that wasn't my own, I wouldn't be happy either. They aren't happy. Are you sure the Levies aren't happy? They only seem so. Her face is flat, unreadable. They're not. And they only seem happy, I guess. They look the same. She shrugs. They're made by a machine at the Order of Truth. That's how they look when they're born. They don't really look the same, but the differences are subtle. If you want to become a citizen, you step into a machine at the Order of Truth. It takes away a year of your life and uses that year to create a new Levy. I have other questions. She nods. Go on then. Who are you again? I'm the captain of Levies. They used to report directly to a member of the council, but that made the others paranoid, so they wanted a neutral party. I was more qualified than anyone else. She thinks, there was no neutral party before I showed up. So get more information this time. Sigyn, the captain of Levies. How did you become the captain of Levies? Why were you qualified for the job? Most people sacrifice 1 year of their lives to become a citizen. From their sacrifice, a single Levy is born. I sacrificed more. Voluntarily. I gave up more years than anyone ever has. It helped me to understand the Levies, and it helped them to understand me. Why would you do that? Because I wanted to serve the city. That's what I told the Aeon Priest. You can believe it if you want. It's a good enough reason for him. She thinks, and I'm still serving the city. I suppose it was truth in its way. I've become captain again. Yeah. What were you saying to these drones? They carry my orders to Levies all over the city, and they bring reports from the Levies back to me. She reaches out a hand, and one of the drones buzzes something unintelligible. A few years ago, the Aeon Priests found them buried underground and brought them back to life. I learned their language, so our conversations are safe from prying ears. What's in the building behind you? She frowns. How is it that you don't recognize the seat of government? I know you lived here for a time. She thinks, I must learn more about these cast-offs. Something isn't right about them. Ooh, nasty. To tell you the truth, I've lost my memory. Indigo raised. You've lost more than that. I've seen images of you. Through the eyes of the drones. 10 years ago, you moved differently. Carried yourself like a king in a steadfast. You've lost your soul. Or gained one. She thinks, she's not who she was. That's a pain I understand all too well. I don't mean to be harsh. She gives you a faint smile. Thank you for being honest with me. She waves a hand at the doors behind her. The council meets in there. A representative from every slave family and from some of the guilds, depending on who's in favor. Hardly anyone goes in through the doors, though. They're just a formality. Most people have other ways of getting inside. And out. I've never seen a building like this one before. What is it? They say it's a ship. Built by the ancients to sail the void between worlds. Now the crag grips it tight, like an old husband holds his wife, and it'll never sail free again. That's one hell of a comparison. The seat of government. The council meets inside. They don't use these doors, so there's no way of knowing if they're in session. Maybe the clerk can tell you. You don't like Metkina? I don't like assassins, especially good ones. I don't like the temptation they represent to people in power, to the people I'm supposed to serve. They make it too easily to solve problems discreetly. She pauses as if debating whether to go on. Then she does. I don't like the fact that whenever I scratch the surface of a wound in this city, it leads back to someone with a tattoo like yours. Huh? Yeah, I'm not gonna give him up like that. Done. Farewell to you, wherever you really are. The clerk notes your approach, as an Anine would note the return of a particularly ravenous bloodfly, an annoyance to be addressed and driven off lest matters grow worse. She told me I could ask him. What is it this time? Alright, never mind. The smooth metal door has no apparent handle or hinge. Entry must be controlled from inside. So next episode, guys, we're gonna mess with this thing. And if we don't get sent to a completely different time, I'll check out the Order of Truth after that. See you next time and enduring. Go strong.